gripping me. Oh, I can't thank you enough. Favor. Yeah, grace. Oh, time and time again. Oh, grace. You never left my side. Oh, grace. Yeah, nobody can do me like you do. You do. Thank you for bringing me through. Oh,
I want you to know wherever you need God's grace, it's always sufficient, on time, and exactly what you need.
Sometimes there are obstacles in the road that can leave you feeling low, and you don't know how to move forward. And sometimes there are turns you want to take, but the way gets hard to trace. Now you're wondering, how did you get here? But don't you give up until you see how God is ordering your steps, so you can walk into your season. He that has begun a great work in you is faithful to perform. God is faithful to perform. He that has begun a great work in you is faithful to perform it. Our God is faithful. I declare you will know the favor of the Lord and receive a harvest for your seed. To bless the world as it flows.
He that has begun
a great work,
great work in you
is faithful to perform it.
God is faithful to perform.
Oh, he that has begun a great work in you is faithful to perform it. God is faithful to perform it. Yourself and say, God is doing a great work. He's doing a great work. He's doing a great work in me. God is doing a great work. He's doing a great work. He's doing a great work in me.
God is doing a great work.
So what should be considered
work,
as we proceed
work,
is that this work did not
work,
begin with you. Our mother's mothers and father's fathers planted seeds when we were but the faint notion of a dream in their mind. They hoped for a harvest, a legacy, a great work.
lesson again. Noah was successful because he obeyed God, not because anybody didn't come, mm-hmm. but because of his obedience.
We say good morning. Praise the Lord. We do honor the Spirit of Christ today. We're certainly grateful to him again for blessing us to come together, that we might again look into the Word of God. Our purpose is to hear what thus saith the Lord, that we might be blessed according to every promise that's written in this book. For God has done a great work through Jesus Christ, that those of us whom the Word declared did not even have a God mm-hmm. on our side, mm-hmm. that we might be again able to come into the ark of safety and be saved from the wrath to come. God is a God of mercy. God is a God of patience. He is a God of love, but God will, through Jesus Christ, become a God of judgment. And he will bring judgment on those who do not give ear to the Word of God. That's why the scripture says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Just before coming on, Pastor and I, in discussion about, you know, our responsibility, you know, and simple for us. Mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't always right. that way. It wasn't always that way, but it has become very simple for us that what we need to do is to preach. And I'm not talking standing behind a podium in a pulpit. I'm simply saying preach what God says by rehearsing over and over what God says to the people and to the church. So that's what we're going to do. We're not going to take down because nobody wants to hear us. That's not on me. My job is, what would be on me is if I don't say mm-hmm. what God says. You know, we had a lesson 2 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago now, coming up on 3 weeks, where the writer said there are three things that happens when we preach or when we're teaching mm-hmm. God's word. You know, there is always indifference. I said on last week that if your preacher's not preaching salvation through repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, and the receiving of the Holy Ghost, you're being cheated. Now, you can stay there. That's your indifference. That's your indifference because you don't see it that way. The other is there's a condemnation, you know, that when you hear the word, it does something to you. It condemns you. Some of us get mad when uh-huh. the word of God condemns us because we look at the man. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We think that he's all up in our business when it's God that's talking to you. That's why we have to have a relationship with the Lord, that we hear him. And the third is conviction. You then, when the word finds you out, it finds you out. We had Bible study on Wednesday, and one of our deacons shared with us about the woman at Samaria. And I mean, certainly you read it, you think about it, but it just hit me when he said it. The word went looking for her, and the word come looking for us. And that's when the conviction comes. When the word shows up through whoever God has sent to give it to you, and then, you know, we can change, or we can elect to be indifferent, or we can elect to just simply be condemned. So we have, again, a wonderful lesson, and as we go, because we're still studying from salvation and Acts, and as we go into our lesson and study, then we ask that God would certainly continue to open understanding. You know what? One thing, I'll say this and give it to Pastor, one thing I have come to. You know, I don't sit here discouraged. Mm-mm. Because the word of God has already declared that God's word shall not return mm-hmm. to him void. Right. But whatever God sends it to do, it will accomplish that. I may never see the results of it. But when God's working on you, you know it. You know what I'm saying? And listen, if one soul is saved, we have done our job. So we rest in that fact that we're only doing what the Lord has called us to do. We do honor our pastor as always. We certainly are grateful for the man of God. And as he bring us into our lessons, greet you and bring us into our lesson, we sit prayerfully. Hopefully you do too. And today is another one of those days that you might want to grab a piece of paper and a pencil and write these salvation scriptures down.
Again, we say good morning and praise the Lord, and we thank God again for this wonderful opportunity that God has blessed us and have allowed us to come together to study his word and to see what wonderful things God has in store for us. We do give honor to our teacher, and we thank God for him, and we thank God for how he opened us up this morning, because I was going to say the same thing when he said the word, when it finds you out, you get angry, because now you there's a conviction. And he said again, it is not us. You know, we didn't come to tear down anything. We didn't come to destroy anything. But God said his word. Paul says it this way: I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation. Other word, God's word is going to do the work. So all we're going to do is share the word, and the word of God will do what's necessary to be done for those to come unto him before it's a day and hour too late. So just pray with us and pray for us that we just allow God to be God in us and through us, and that your ears may be open to hear what thus saith the Lord. For October the 13th, 2024, our series, Salvation in Acts, and our topic for this morning, Salvation for Every Nation. Our focus verse is coming from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 through 35. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of person, but in every nation he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Lesson text is coming from Acts 10, verses 30 through 48. Truth about God. God's plan and promises are bigger than my preconceptions or my prejudices. Truth for my life. I will not let my prejudices or my preconceptions limit what God can do through me. Our icebreaker for this morning, what is the biggest surprise in the Bible? Our lesson outline, angel in the afternoon, Cornelius' devotion. Cornelius desired more than what he had experienced. Regardless of my past experience, I will seek everything God has for me. A praying preacher. God changes Peter's assumption. Prayer changes Peter's perspective. I will go outside my comfort zone so others may be saved. An unexpected outpouring. Peter preached Jesus as Lord of all, including the Gentiles. God astonished Jewish Christians by saving Gentiles. I will not let my prejudices and my preconceptions limit what God can do through me. Father, it is in your name, Lord Jesus Christ, that we come now before you to tell you thank you for another privilege and another opportunity that we have, oh God, to look into your word. Lord, you know our hearts, you know our minds, and you know even know what we're thinking. And Lord, this lesson may challenge us to a degree because there are things that we've been taught for so long, God, and to change is like we're going against what we've been taught. There's habits and those things that we've done for so long. But Father, have us to lay aside everything that is not like you. Let your word make it clear, Lord. I know it may be a fight in this flesh, but as your word unfolds unto us, Lord, bless us that we give way to your word. Bless us, oh God, that we move our prejudices of who we think should be saved and who we think we ought to go to. But in our lesson, we find that this word is for everyone. For everyone that is walking on the face of this earth is a child of yours, Lord. And oh God, and we are all related through making of us. So Lord, bless us this day that we move aside. I'm not saying it's going to be easy, oh God, but through your spirit, everything is possible. So Lord, bless us that we humble ourselves and submit ourselves into your hands, that we move, oh God, from our comfort zone, and that we allow you, oh God, to send us where you would have us to go, that we will open our mouth and say what we have to say, and have us to understand that the responsibility of them coming is not on us, oh God, but it will be on you and your word. bless us that we just be obedient and do what thus saith the Lord, that we plant the seed or we break the ground or we water, whatever it is, oh God, that you have called us to do. Bless God that we trust you and do it in your name. Oh God, whether we see the results or not, we would have the victory and we would be blessed of God because we were obedient unto what he said. Now bless and have your way this day, that our ears and eyes may be open to hear, to see, and receive what you have prepared for us. In Jesus' name is our prayer we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, we started this lesson with Acts 2:38 when Peter was questioned about what needed to be done to receive salvation. And, so salvation is exposed to us in the book of Acts. This is how we come into that salvation. It didn't come until the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. When Jesus then ascended into heaven, he had promised in John that he would send a comforter because he knew that he would no longer be there physically with those that had come to follow him, come to know him, come to believe that he was God in Jesus Christ. So Peter told them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the remission of your sin. That where we would be covered by the shed blood of Jesus on the cross. Excuse me. When we come to the cross, we recognize that Jesus took our sins upon us. Listen, we were told this probably 20 years ago, and you got to get this. Jesus never died. He never died. The physical body died because sin killed it. But Jesus never died. We will never die because if we come, we will have salvation and then we will be able to live with the Lord Jesus Christ in eternity. But even if we don't receive salvation here, we still won't die. We will just be cast into the outer darkness and where the word of God says, and there will be gnashing of teeth. Well, we will be in that place that there is no return. So Peter told them to repent, be baptized, and that's the beginning of salvation. Remember, they were waiting in the upper room when they were endowed with the power of salvation. And as we follow the writings in the book of Acts, you will see salvation come upon those who are seeking God and then some are not necessarily seeking him, but they're brought into the presence of the word of God and then their hearts are pricked. They will change their minds. As Pastor was saying, they'll come out of the traditions. They'll come out of the associations. They'll come out of those beliefs that they've had when they now see in the word of God that those things are not the fulfillment. Even our lesson today says that there was one who was righteous in his own moral acts, but he was yet missing something. And so we find that we're forced to go. I tell you that every Sunday morning we come online and begin to share the word of God with you, we're doing it in opposition. In the face of opposition, because there are those that may come on, they may follow us, they may come on after we have gone off and view the lesson later on, but there's an opposition. I'm going to see what they're going to say today, Or there are preachers who telling their members, y'all don't need to follow them. That's where salvation is. It's in the face of opposition. And then today's lesson, God's intent is that there is salvation from every nation. Even on the day of Pentecost, there were nations from all around. All of them didn't believe. All of them didn't hear. But that's God's intent. But now as salvation unfolds in the book of Acts, you will begin to see even those nations that didn't have a God on their side will come under the umbrella of what Jesus Christ has done through his death, burial, and resurrection.
If we understand and if we follow God's word, how God has mapped it out for us, and I guess sometimes the Holy Ghost makes it simple and easy for us to understand, but those that don't have God's spirit, sometimes it sounds contradictory or it's hard to accept or receive. Jesus, what God wanted to do was have a people that would get to know him and spread this word to others of this salvation, that they will know the goodness and the greatness of God. God didn't choose a rich country. He didn't choose a whole lot of people. He chose a despised nation that he could use to spread this word to everyone that is in the world. But because the Jews thought that it was only for them and that no one else was to receive this, they kept it to themselves. So actually, the purpose and the plan that God had for the world, for the Jews to do, it failed. So now Jesus Christ comes on the scene, and he is trying to establish, a people that will spread this good news of salvation unto the world. I know he says one time he was still trying to get the Jews in connection or to get them to follow, but still out of unbelief, they didn't follow. So what Jesus did, he got these 12 men, these disciples, and if you follow their background, all of them weren't Jews. There was a mixed group of people in the 12 that followed him. And he showed them and he taught them the time on these 3 years that his ministry began. He showed, it was teaching them what they had to do, how they had to conduct themselves, and the people that they had to reach. Well, Jesus recognized and realized that they couldn't do this on their own, of their own authority, their own power. He told them in the book of Acts, go into the upper room and wait till you are endued with power from on high, which will give you the authority and the power to do what I have done and what I'm teaching you to do. And he also said to them, now look, in Matthew 28, before you, he said, look, all power is given unto me in heaven and on the earth. Now I want you to go to, listen, all nations, and baptize them and teaching them about me. But in order for all of us to be on one accord, saying the same thing to carry out this commission of Jesus, we must receive the power of the Holy Ghost. For the Holy Ghost will teach us, guide us, and direct us in all truth, and only tell us to say what Jesus said. And in order for us to be on one accord, in order for us to preach the same message, there isn't but one way to God. And the only way to God is repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance of the authority of the evidence that God's Spirit has entered into us to carry on the commission that Jesus has given us. Though we have many churches and though we are teaching many different doctrines, there isn't but one. That is the doctrine of the Bible, that is of Jesus Christ. And how do you come into the church? How do you become a follower of Jesus? Acts tell us. Repent, baptize, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. This is the only way. Any other way is a contradiction. Any other way is false. It says, except you come through the door. Who is the door? Jesus Christ. The thief may try to get over the wall, around the gate. That's the thief. Well, and then teacher said again, if your pastor say don't listen to them because of what they're saying, well, do this. Follow the word. Follow us through the Bible. See what the word says. Are we saying anything against the Bible? But if we're saying what the Bible says, then that's what, and then we are Christian and we are church folk, this is what we ought to be listening to, the Bible, the word of God. For it is going to direct us. He said again, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the church. And if you have not the Spirit, you're not going to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, because the Spirit connects with the Spirit. For if you have not God's Spirit, you have none of his. So you can't understand what God's word is saying. What else, teacher and I do not, we're trying to now teach God's word in a simplistic way that you can understand how to get to God, then and you receive his instructions, then the way would open up. Then you will understand what we're saying and what we're trying to do.
So let's start with our truth for or truth about God or truth for my life. Either one of them, it says truth about God. It says God's plans and promises are bigger than preconceptions or prejudice. Mm-hmm. Now, it's not just, you know, when we begin to look at different nations, but certainly it is looking at nationalities, ethnicities, differences. But, you know, what it says is that a preconception is a conception or an opinion that is formed beforehand. You know, the opinion is simply this. Well, I don't see it that way. Well, that's not what we're taught. So you have an opinion already beforehand. Before we begin to share what's in God's word, you already feel like, well, that's not what we believe. That's not how we believe it. And the prejudice is an unfavorable an opinion, not necessarily about the color of somebody's skin or where they it's unfavorable when I say repent and you said, well, I don't believe that. That's an unfavorable. You have a prejudice about what God is saying. So it's a greater knowledge to understand what it is when you don't accept the word of God, when you don't accept salvation. So we're studying today from the 10th chapter of the book of Acts. And this is another account of those that are coming under the umbrella of salvation and how they get there. But it begins with breaking preconceptions and prejudice. So the law says, in the law of Moses, you know, when God in the book of Leviticus began to lay down the law, there were certain things that were not allowed. But this is a called people. And this people first has to show their obedience just to follow the word of God. Salvation is not here yet, mm-hmm. but they need to follow the obedience of God. And God had some stipulations. He had some rules. He had some commandments. He had some, you know, regulations that they had to follow. And, okay, of course, it is about learning to understand what God is saying. And so there were things in the book where there were certain things that were all right for them to do and things that were not. And in this particular case, it was about food. You know, and listen, I mean, people got, it's still they got it wrong. But some people, not all people, some people still got it wrong. Peter had a need to go into prayer. And so in the 10th chapter, the book tells us he goes to the roof to pray. Now, he also wanted to eat. And while they were preparing the food for him to eat, he went to pray. And he fell asleep. I guess he was tired. But not only did he fall asleep, he fell into a trance. And in this trance, he sees this he sees this vision coming down from heaven. And it says it was like a sheet that was tied in four corners with all manner of beast in it. Well, listen, I don't know about you. If you ever go to sleep hungry, then you dream about food. Well, Peter goes into a trance and he begins to dream. And the word of God says, Peter, arise, slay and eat. Well, when he looks at this vision, there are things in there that in the Old Testament, they were considered unclean. So now God has to change his mind. But listen, if we're not open to the word of God, then we're going to miss God. God says, slay and eat. And Peter says, Lord, nothing common or unclean has passed my lips. This happened three times. And eventually, Peter comes to the knowledge that this must be God talking to me. But now God is fulfilling what was in the Old Testament because
That was only to bring us into the place that we are obedient to God. Well, we still got to be obedient. And listen, God isn't changing his word. He isn't changing it. He is bringing light. Remember in John 1, it says, he's the light of the world. He was in the world, but yet the world still couldn't comprehend him because we didn't have what we needed to be able to understand. I think Pastor said, listen, without the Holy Ghost, we can't come to the fullness of understanding God's word. And even with the Holy Ghost, we have to study to right. show ourselves approved of God, right? Mm-hmm. We can't just come to this thing on our own. It is brought to us by the Holy Spirit of God, and God is, because the Bible says, the Holy Ghost will do what? Teach us. Mm-hmm. So we got to have it if we're going to be taught. So as Peter now is introduced to something not new, not different, it is just with a greater understanding of it, and that's all we're doing. We're not bringing you anything different. We're not bringing you anything new. We're just trying to shed light on what God has already said through this call to salvation.
You see, then that teacher was talking about then Peter eating and all types of food that was there. And he told Peter to rise, slay, and eat. And again, nothing common nor unclean has crossed these lips. God, but then God said, Peter, call nothing that I have made common nor unclean. Other words, Jesus was giving Peter a change of his diet to show him that what he has made or what he has cleansed has not now become clean and usable for his purpose. And he was saying to Peter now, because I have cleansed it, mm-hmm. you know, and what we have done, again, just teach myself sidebar, a lot of food today we won't eat because what the Bible says years ago in the Old Testament was unclean. And a lot say, I don't eat this now because the Bible says don't eat pork and don't eat this and don't eat that. Well, Jesus letting Peter know in Mark 7:18 through 20, it's not what goes into the body that defiles a man and what comes out. He said, because what you eat come out in the draught anyway. But what's in your heart, that's the thing that defiles the person. What comes out of your heart, that's defiling of the person. So it's not the food that we eat. But Peter, he was saying, Peter, I'm changing your diet because, in other words, what I was trying to signify and show you that the Gentile nation, what we have called unclean for so long, I have blessed them now. Don't call them common and unclean anymore because I'm going to send you to them for them also to be a part of this salvation that I have brought first to the Jews and I have brought to them also. And but in order for them to understand what it is, they have to go through the same process that you went through, repentance, baptism, receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. So now Cornelius, as teacher said, he was a devout man. He was a Roman soldier, Roman citizen. And he wanted to understand more. He had gotten something from what he heard, and he wanted more. So while Cornelius was praying, Peter was praying, and what God was doing was preparing Peter for the people that Cornelius was going to send to the house to find out more about what this salvation was all about. And then as Cornelius was praying, he was a devout man. And because Cornelius was praying out of his heart and wanted to understand and wanted to know about this salvation, God sent an angel to say to him, he said, I want you to go now and send your men to Joppa. There's one called Simon, surnamed Peter. He is praying. Send your men to fetch him and bring him back to you because what he is going to do, he is going to make things clear and give you a better understanding of what you're looking after. Well, there are some praying today and there are some seeking understanding. And what happened is, I'm not saying the teacher and I are angels, but God is sending his word through us that you may receive it, that will bring you clarity and bring it, what we are, his angels.
We are.
All right. To bring you his clarity and bring understanding to you. God has dispatched us. But it's up to us whether we want to accept and receive what the word of God is saying. One of the things that I've studied before, what hinders Israel so much, is because like the Bible says, I think it's still in Hebrews, that to this very day, they still read the scripture with blinders on. That it has happened what Jesus has said has happened. And even though I've seen what's happened, I still read the scriptures with blinders. I still read from what I've been taught. I still read what I understand. And what I have to do to understand the scripture is what I have to empty my glass, that something else can come in to bring me clarity. But if I'm reading with a full glass, there's nothing going to come in because I'm full already and nothing else can get in there. Cornelius was hungry. Cornelius wanted something. Cornelius wanted understanding. Cornelius wanted truth. And Jesus fixed Peter. You see, he worked on Peter that Peter would be prepared to go to see Cornelius and bring forth the word. So while Peter was praying, by the time he came out of the prayer, the people that Cornelius sent to the house, they met Peter. And Jesus told Peter, these men come for you. Go with them, for there's something, there's one praying, there's one seeking. You need to go to him. So, well, Peter goes. He goes to him. And what he does, he started explaining or start giving the word of God. And what he did, he didn't go by himself. He took some of his Jewish brothers along with him to let them see what was going to happen, how God was going to establish this thing. And then, like God says in his word, with two or three of witnesses, every word will be established. So Peter carried some witnesses along with him that that what God was about to do would be established, that there would be no doubts, that the Gentile nation who was considered unclean, that God has sanctified them, that they would receive the word also. So as Peter starts teaching, as Peter starts preaching to them, the Holy Ghost fell, and they spoke in tongues. And Peter baptized them in Jesus' name. And so that there would be no disagreement, Peter said to them, brethren, you heard them speak as we have spoken. They spoke in tongues. God is dwelling within them. Now, what hinders us from baptizing them in Jesus' name? And Peter says, I perceive that God is not a respecter of person, that the Gentile nation should receive the gift of the Holy Ghost also. So what God is saying to us, regardless of gender, regardless of background, religious background, ethnic group, whatever, the Holy Ghost is for everyone that will accept it. And we are to go wherever God sends us to everyone, regardless of who they are, regardless of what they have done to us. If God sends us, let us not be like Jonah. Because when Jonah went to Nineveh, because the Nineveh was such a hated group and did the Jews so bad, Jonah didn't want to do it. Because Jonah said, I know you're a merciful God, and I know you're going to save them, God, but I want to see justice fall on them. God said, no, I'm a God of mercy. I'm going to give them the opportunity also to receive this gift that I've given to you.
So just, again, to be enlightened of the vision of Peter. This is Jesus Christ as he has always taught, mm-hmm. parable to spiritual. Jesus used the unclean food to declare to Peter, if I've made it, and he already said, if you bless it, then it's clean. But he says, I want you to understand this is really not about the food. This is about men. The men that, as Pastor said, they're going to come seeking you. You're going to have to go to them. But you need to understand before you go to them that I've already declared, because it's my intent that every nation comes under salvation. Well, we go back to the gospel writing when Jesus went to the woman at the Samaria well, you know, where these people didn't have a right because they could not prove their pedigree as being full Jews. But Jesus already began to show us then that he would include them. Well, I mean, I think it's chapter 7 is when Philip and Stephen are preaching both to the eunuch and to those that are there. And what happens is, but this is how it was. If you're going to live for the Lord, then, well, let me read this verse. It's in Acts 10 and 28. And this is Peter talking. He says, and Peter said unto them, ye know how that it is unlawful, an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto another nation, but God hath showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. But prior to this, the only way that they could come into their company, if they had performed the rites of circumcision, you know, if they were willing to live according to the law of Moses, then listen, they still weren't Jews, but then we could at least come into your company. And because even in the Old Testament, it says, and if a man was willing to follow the law, then he should be considered, right, not Jew, but he should be considered as one. So what's important about this? Listen to this. When the word of God says, it's talking about this fellow Cornelius. He's a prayerful man. He's praying daily. He has been showered by the presence of the anointing, but it has not entered in him. But he has a mind. Even though he's praying and he's doing the alms, you know, he's paying the tributes that, but Cornelius says to himself, this can't be all to salvation. It's just like people in churches. I mean, listen, you go to a church and you listen to the preacher preach, and when all y'all leave, y'all go out into the world and y'all do everything the world does. It's got to be more than that. I mean, listen, there may not be any conviction because that's what you want to do. You understand? So, but there's got to be a change in your life. And the Holy Ghost brings a change. Cornelius knows, and again, you know, when we look at the centurion back in the gospel, the centurion came to Jesus and told Jesus, you know, he had a servant that was sick and he understand the power of God. And he says, listen, you don't have to come to my, he asked him first, come heal him. And he said, wait a minute, you ain't got to come, just speak the word. Well, the centurion is a person of authority. Cornelius is a person of authority. He, you know, but listen, Cornelius knows that he can't command, right? He can't command salvation. He has to go by what the word of God says. He's just like Simon, you know, who Simon was a little bit ignorant because he thought he could buy it. When he saw what the apostles had done by laying on their hands, and I think it's what, 8 that they received the gift of the Holy Ghost. He said, listen, I got money. How about let me pay you for this and you give me this gift? Hey, Peter said, listen, you ain't got no part with us.
That's right.
You misunderstand. This isn't about your money or your riches or who you are or what church you go to or who your pastor is. This doesn't have anything to do with that. No. He says, I believe that your hearts are in the, in the presence of gall, that you think you can buy this. No, you have to be obedient to the word of God. Cornelius is a man who is seeking to be obedient to the word of God, and he wants to do what it is. He says, there's got to be more than what I'm doing. And he wants to be able to do it all. But what? He says, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You remember the eunuch when Philip says, understandeth thou?
Mm-hmm.
What thou readest? He said, how can I? When there's nobody to explain it to me. Well, God needed Peter to go to Cornelius to preach to him so he could understand. But I want you to watch this. Pastor already went through. Cornelius sends his people to get Peter.
Faith come by hearing.
Yeah, get Peter. But in the meantime, you know, Cornelius... Before Peter gets there, there's an anticipation.
Mm-hmm.
So he starts calling everybody to come in. Like Pastor said, Peter brought witnesses to him, with him, so they could see what was going on. But Cornelius had a bunch of people there too that I don't know if they were seeking what Cornelius was seeking, but Cornelius' thing, and Pastor was rehearsing this, for about a year, if you think you got something good,
that's right,
share it.
That's right.
Cornelius started sharing even before he got there.
Mm-hmm.
He got people to come in. So when Peter got there and Peter began to preach, not only will Cornelius hear it, but he wanted his family and all of his neighbors, now I don't know if the whole 100 people that he had command over were there or not. It doesn't matter. If there's two or three there, right?
Right.
And they receive the Holy Ghost, then that's what it's all about. So, but there is a devotion, and there are so many people in this world that have great devotion, great devotion. They go through the rituals of church, being churchy. But no, we have to come into salvation, and we're only going to get there when we're like Cornelius, when we're hungry for more than just being churchy, but hungry for salvation.
You know, a lot of times I think y'all may look at us and think that we don't understand, and we don't know what some of you are dealing with and some of your thoughts, but I can say I do. And the reason why I was like this, I went to church on Sunday, and the preacher read his message every Sunday, and the same way I came to church was the same way I went back home. Didn't get anything. But I was raised, if I call a name, I don't want to make people upset, but where I would pray to Jesus, I would pray to God, and I would pray to the Holy Spirit. I would make sure I covered all three of them, because that's what I thought. And I would go to church on Sunday, but Monday through Friday through Saturday, I drank, I smoked, I did what I wanted to do, and went to church on Sunday, but still there was nothing there to condemn me. And one day, you know, I would pass by the church and make the sign of the cross, and that made everything all right. And I tried to do this thing by works. Didn't want to use any big curse words, and, you know, didn't want to mess up anything. So I thought I was doing pretty good. And one day I said to myself, I said, you know, Lord, it got to be something better than this. God, I'm going over the same thing over and over and over again. It's like a rerun, it's a rut. I said, got to be something better than this. And then what happened not long ago, you know, my brother and I used to run together, and he was coming to church all the time, and I got invited to the church. I came to church. And when the pastor started preaching, I was uncomfortable. I never felt that way before in church. Man, I was ducking, I was sliding, I was moving like my seat was hot. I was trying to get away from the preaching, from this man's preaching. But after church, I said to my mother-in-law, but she wasn't my mother-in-law at the time, Mom, I'm not coming back, Ms. Witherspoon, I'm not coming back to this church no more, because y'all preacher been talking about me, and I don't like that. I ain't coming back. She said, Russell, it's not that he was talking about you. He was talking about the things, not him. The word was revealing to you the things that you were doing. The word was called. So in other words, Jesus had a hold on me. That I love you so much, I'm going to reveal to you stuff that you are doing that you don't want people to know about. And it made me uncomfortable. I didn't like it. And I said, you know what? That's all. And I said, I ain't coming back no more. When she explained to me, I said, I don't care. I ain't coming back no more. But there's a difference when Jesus got a hold on you. Because I had that encounter, I couldn't rest. Something kept saying to me, you got to go back. You got to go back. You got to go back. And I fought it as long as I could. And I went back. And the more I went back, you know, then God started infiltrating my heart to the place where I did repent, to the place where I got baptized, and the place where I received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, what I had to do now is go, because I hadn't changed churches yet. I got saved over here. I said, you know what, now I got to go back and tell my mom, I got to go back and break tradition. I got to go back and break habit. Mom, I got to change churches. You got to do what? I got to go to another church. See, my biggest fear was hurting my mama's feeling. I didn't want to go against the people at the other church. I didn't want them to think anything bad about me. I became a little deacon over there. I didn't know what it meant, but I was a deacon over there. I didn't know how to deacon before that, but I was a deacon. And you know, and so, you know, I was carrying on. And I said, you know, Mom, I got to leave. And my mom said, Russ, do you have to leave? I said, yeah, Mom, I got to go because I'm not being fed here. I need to go where I'm being, my soul is being fed. And she said, well, if you got to go, you need to write the preacher a letter. And look. And see, and one of the things, when you know you got to do something, they didn't tell us in football, don't think long, you think wrong. My mom said, you need to write the pastor a letter. Okay, I started writing that letter quick to let him know before I change my mind, I got to leave here. I want you to release me. I'm going someplace else. And I went, and God blessed me. Now, to make the long story short, by me doing what I did, by me receiving the right information about salvation, I went back to my mom, and I told her what happened to me. She started coming over here, and guess what happened to her? She got saved. And when she got saved, she started telling her other friends about the goodness of God. So see, sometimes when we hesitate to move, we're holding up what God want to do, not only for you, but for others. You would be the key if you would move. If you would move from where you are, stop worrying about who you're going to hurt. Stop worrying about what people are going to say. It might not feel good right now, but I guarantee you one thing. If you make that move, there's going to be a blessing not only for you, but to others also.
So there's some things that has to happen. First, the assumption that you have about salvation has to be challenged. Mm. And that's challenged when you hear something
right.
different.
Yes.
But you have to change your perspective by what you hear, if it's true. I'm going to share this as quick as I can. I was used to go to a Bible study with some of the business leaders of Sumter. And I have a very good friend who said, you know, and I met, it's in John 3rd chapter when, and this is going to be challenging, just like salvation for some of you is challenging. I said, based on the scripture, that nobody's in heaven.
Right.
And he said, huh? Now, this is what he said to me just recently. He said that. He said, I can kind of understand what he's saying, because if I got to heaven and my mama wasn't there, then I probably wouldn't be happy. And he said, there's only supposed to be joy. And I said, but okay, I gave you a scripture.
Mm-hmm.
All you need to do is give me two scriptures that says somebody's in heaven. And then I'll change my mind. Well, I ain't found one. Okay. So then how many scriptures do you need to say there's nobody in heaven but Jesus? Unless you can find two scriptures that says there is somebody else, then okay, we shouldn't even have to discuss that. We ought to just accept it. What am I saying? So, throughout the book of Acts, everybody that come into salvation, there's enough scriptures here to declare to you that none of them came without repenting. Mm-hmm. Now, listen, don't get the order twisted.
Right.
Don't get the order twisted. Now, we got to repent. But whether you're baptized or received the gift of the Holy Ghost first, that doesn't matter. Now, we always say it in the order that mm-hmm. Jesus gave it to us. Baptized in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's in the name of Jesus. First, repent. John mm-hmm. came preaching even before Jesus declared it. John came preaching, repent. So that's the first thing we've got to do. Then be baptized. Then he says, now go to Jerusalem, wait until you're endowed with power. That's when they receive together the Holy Ghost. And we'll get a hang up. Well, you didn't get it right. Well, listen, in Acts, some of them received the gift of the Holy Ghost by laying on their hands. Mm-hmm. Some of them weren't baptized, and some of them then, it's a reversal. So, I mean, listen, God does what God wants to do through Jesus Christ. We're not going to get hung up on that. But when our perspectives change, then we can, because see what it does when your perspective changes, what Pastor was just sharing, what happened to him? He was comfortable where he was, but he had to come out of his comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we do. I mean, listen, I am comfortable not sitting here every Sunday. No, I am. I'm comfortable sitting here every Sunday not telling you what the Word of God says, right? But that's not what I'm called to do. So it takes me sometimes out of my comfort zone. Mm-hmm. But the one thing I can tell you is what I'm saying is according to the scripture. Mm-hmm. So it's God's word. So then that's what gives me that level of comfort that I can say. You know why? Because it ain't on me. When Peter went to Cornelius, he didn't go because it was what he wanted to do. Because listen, Peter went with prejudice. Mm-hmm. He went with preconceived notions that they didn't have anything to do with it. But then after what Jesus did in his presence, then he says, oh, Lord.
Right.
What can I say?
Right.
And listen, I ain't fixed to fight this thing by myself. Brothers?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Did y'all see? That's right. Mm-hmm. Did y'all see what I saw? Mm-hmm. And they said, yeah, we saw it.
So now, what should hinder them?
Yes. We need to do what God has called us mm-hmm. to do. And that's what we do. Listen, I looked at my watch and I'm saying, no, we have not been teaching already that long. But there's so much in this lesson. So I give it to you. It's Acts 10. We still have a few minutes, but it's Acts mm-hmm. 10. Please spend some time reading Acts 10 with an understanding that God is opening up your eyes, your hearts, and your minds that you might receive this.
And again, go to Acts 19 also. When Paul talks to some of John's disciples that were baptized unto repentance, and Paul asked them, have you received in other words, church folk, if you believe, a lot of people in the church, he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? It's the Holy Ghost. We had not even heard there be such a thing as the Holy Ghost. He said, well, then what baptism are you baptized in? He said, we are baptized under John's baptism, the baptism of repentance. Mm-hmm. In other words, the name hadn't been given yet as far as salvation was concerned. He said, in other words, if you allow me, I was baptized in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The Bible tells us to be baptized in the name. Mm-hmm. And Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are not names. They are titles. So if someone was baptized in the name of the Father, watch what it says. Baptized in the name of the Father. Okay, what's the name of the Father? Father. No, that don't sound right. Hmm. Baptize them in the name of the Son. Son. No, that's not his name. Baptize them in the name of the Holy Ghost. No. Baptize them in Jesus' name. That's the name. So when Paul talked to them, Paul said, then what name were you baptized? He said, we were baptized under John. Father. So Paul baptized them. No, Paul laid his hands mm-hmm. on them when they heard this, and they received the Holy Ghost, and they spoke in tongues, and they were baptized in Jesus' name. So sometimes we say, well, baptism. No, it is the name that makes mm-hmm. the difference. See, some of us want to sprinkle. That's not what the Bible says. That's tradition. Some of us just want a mark on your head. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible said to be submerged or immerged in water. In Romans it says, as he came up out of the water. So in other words, you have to go under to be cleansed and to leave the old man there. So this is what the Bible says. Again, if you look at Paul, in the 9th chapter of Acts, how he was then and the things that he was doing. Although he was a religious man, mm-hmm. as far as the law concerned, Paul kept the law. He said, I'm blameless. But then when he met Jesus, so other words, there was a turnaround. There's something happened. Even though he knew the law, even though he was a righteous man, but still he was not a friend of God. So what happens is when he met Jesus and then he got saved, you can see the turnaround now. Paul is no longer preaching law. Paul is preaching Jesus. He's preaching the word. And he said, you know what? I could boast and brag about my superiority, about my background, about my teachings, about my all this, but it don't mean nothing. He said, but meeting Christ, all this other stuff, I count it as dung. So what teacher opened up with, when he first started, he said about we're going to live forever, but our souls, though our bodies may die, our souls going to live forever. And it's our choice where they live, whether with God or separated from God. These words that we are giving you now, these instructions are the words that we are giving that you may receive them to live with God, mm-hmm. to live throughout eternity with him. But if you don't receive or accept these, you will live in separation from him. You know, as many people don't think, but the Bible talks of hell also. So in other words, it's not just something we say we're trying to scare about it, but it says in Revelation that they were cast into the lake of fire with brimstone and stuff. So in other words, when we don't accept what the word of God says, this is our results.
So we need to understand the intent of the reason that Jesus came into the world. Mm-hmm. In Isaiah 40 and 52, it says, look upon me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there is none else. So the only way you can come into salvation is through God. Who is God? Jesus Christ. He is God among us. In 1 Timothy 2 and 4, it says, who will have all men to be saved? Mm-hmm. And to come unto the knowledge of truth. That's all we're trying to do. Share the truth of God's word with you, that you have an opportunity. Listen, Jesus died for the world. And in his superior knowledge, you know, he is omniscient, omniscience. He knows all things. He knew before the world began that we would be sitting here behind this table teaching, and he knew that still people would hear the truth and still not come. He died, and he knew people weren't going to be saved. He knew people would still die and go to hell. That did not stop him from giving his life. It's not going to stop us from teaching. Why? Because he says it is not the will of God. Why? That any should perish, but that we might all come to the knowledge of truth. So if you don't have a preacher to preach truth, that's what our purpose is, to preach truth to you so you can come to it. At least you have an opportunity. If you never heard it, then you can't come. But if you hear it and don't come, that's your choice. And that's how God made us. He made us of a free will. We can choose to do what we want. We can choose to continue living the life that we're living, or we can choose to seek his face and ask God to help us, bring us into the light, out of that darkness into this marvelous light. So, you know, Revelation 22 and 17 says, and the Spirit and the bride says, come, and let him that heareth say, come, and let him that is athirst come, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. It is an invitation to all nations to come to salvation. But again, it's a choice that we have to make individually. God is not going to force us, because he wants, if you come because you want to come, then you are going to live freely. But if you come because you feel like you're obligated to come, it's like the sower that sowed the seeds. As soon as something comes up that you feel like, well, I don't want to deal with this. I didn't think this how life was going to be if I received the Holy Ghost, then you're going to leave. No, you got to be here. That's why the word of God says, oh, taste and see. You have to know that God is good, and his word is there that we might be able to live in the abundance of life.
Well, see, it's not about the 12 disciples. It's more than 12. When Jesus had the 12, that was his posse, so to speak. But they were to go and baptize and make disciples out of everyone that he came in contact with. If they were making disciples out of everyone that he came in contact with that believed, then our job is what their job was, to go to every nation. Mark 16 says it this way, in Mark 16 and 15, he says, preach the gospel to every creature. In other words, to every person that God sends us to, we ought to preach this word to. And he said, them that believe, they are saved, and them that reject, they are damned. Mm-hmm. But this is what our job is supposed to do. So, and the only way to do this legally, mm-hmm, is the baptism and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. And this is what Paul says. Paul said, though I preach this gospel, mm-hmm, and others be saved, but if I don't bring myself under subjection to the word that I preach, me myself, I will be a castaway. So I may tell you how to be saved, but if I don't follow the instructions, I tell you how to be saved by what the Bible says, I am going to be lost. And what the Bible says is not God's will that any perish, but all come to repentance and come into salvation before it's a day and hour today. Father, it's in your holy name, Lord Jesus Christ. We come to say thank you, O Lord, for the privilege. We come to say thank you, Lord God, for the word. We come to say thank you for the understanding of your word. Father, I thank you for those that have heard. I thank you for those that have received your word, Lord. And I even thank you for, God, those that are still battling, O God. For now, if they're battling, that means your word is working on them, O God. That is something is starting to turn, Lord. Continue to deal with them, oh God. Continue to give them clarity. Continue to give them understanding, oh God, that they may come to a completion in their lives, oh God, that they may receive you before it's a day and an hour too late. And Father, I want to go as far as to say, I thank you for the battling of what they are battling with. Because God, when they are converted, they can use what they went through to help others in their fight come to you before it's a day and hour too late. Because why? They have experienced the same thing. They know what the fight is. They know what they're thinking. They know their feelings. And they can, oh God, contribute this to them to help them receive you when they're fighting the battles of the ones that they will come in contact with. Continue to bless, oh Lord. Continue to have your way. Continue to bless the other brothers and myself, oh God, that we continue to stand firm and stand strong in your word. Regardless of who comes or who goes, who listens, who don't listen, we're going to stand on our post because we are commissioned to do this, oh God, and we are called of you and by you. Continue to bless our lips and our hearts, oh God, that the things that we speak and think be of you, oh God, that will bring glory, honor, and praises unto your name. Continue to bless this people. Continue to have your way, oh God. And continue to let your light so shine in their lives. We're not going to judge by what we see. We're going to thank you, God, for what we know. Do it for your glory and for your honor. For it's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless for the presence of his glory with exceedingly joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. In Jesus' name, let all God's people say together, amen.
Amen. We do thank the Lord for blessing us. We certainly thank him for his presence and using us because we know that we can't do this of ourselves. It takes the anointing of God's Spirit to use us to get his message across to those who he has given ears, who he has removed that heart of stone and given them a heart of flesh where that word can come in and take root. Please, don't walk away with indifference. Don't. Study the word of God. Continue, I mean, listen, to follow us. I extend the invitation. You don't have to leave your church on a Sunday. If you don't have Wednesday night service, now this is on the second and fourth Wednesday, but we have Bible study on those two Wednesdays every month as God will allow. You can come be with us on second and fourth in Bible study with all of your questions, with all of your indifference, and we can show you in the Word of God what God's Word says. It's still up to you to accept it. Please don't form an opinion beforehand. Come and listen. Come and hear what thus saith the Lord directly out of the Word, because what we will do is direct you to the Bible that you can see what is written in the Word of God. Then, as Cornelius did, you can then continue to pray to God for the opening of your understanding, that you'll recognize that there's something greater than just being morally righteous. And please allow the Word to convict you. Because when God's word convicts you, as pastors say, then you recognize you got to move. You got to change. Listen, I was brought up in the church. I'm not going to tell you I was always right in the right place. I was in the church. You know, they say at church but not in church. I was at church. I was. I was here because I didn't have a choice. My parents said, you will be at church. But until I came into the church and allowed the church to come into me by the Holy Ghost, I was just as lost as anybody else, sitting in here every Sunday. I knew all the songs, knew to clap my hand and hold my hands up in praise, but I was lost until I received the Spirit of God. Every one of us, if we want to be a part of the bride of Christ, we have to receive it. You continue to pray for us, we'll continue to pray for you, and we're praying that God is opening your understanding. And I'm praying, like Pastor said, he ain't praying that God take away the battles. He wants you to battle. Because to whom much is given,
much is required.
Much is required. Listen, we love you. And we do enjoy our time with sharing the word of God with you. And hopefully you're enjoying God's word. And so it is our prayer. If it is God's will, we will see you on next Sunday. And we say peace in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.